Appreciate it. And thanks for having us here. We're really honored to be kicking off the Hyde Lecture Series. We saw the poster and the names on that, so it really is quite an honor to be a part of that list. John and I actually flew into to Oklahoma yesterday, and we've had a chance to make a drive through this part of the country, and it's a part of the country that we haven't ever really spent a whole lot of time in. And we see a lot of similarities in this part of the country to where we work in Tennessee. And so we can empathize quite a bit with the design community in a place like Nebraska, coming from Tennessee. When John and I were researching the talk, we did what any diligent researcher would do, which was we started with a Google search. We started looking for lots of different things, but one of the searches we did was on the term flyover states. And we found this, what we've since learned is a pretty famous cover from the New Yorker magazine in 1976 by Saul Steinberg. And we found also a not quite so famous article from 20 years later from the satirical magazine The Onion, which claims of the discovery of the Midwest somewhere between the East and West Coasts. And so we hope that you will agree with us that there's more to us, to people who come from places like Nebraska and Tennessee, than what these monikers of things like flyover states or Middle America or red states might imply. Places like ours have opportunities that might not exist in some of these places we think of as design centers or some of the coastal centers where design trends come down years, months, or years down the road to places like where we operate. Places like ours have urban areas who are reinventing themselves right now in a more organic way than what you might find or what the market might drive in some of these other places. And that can lead to a more a slower, more lasting, and permanent development pattern. We also don't battle the constraint of density in the same way that these other places do. We have vast amounts of open space, and with it, it brings opportunities that might not exist in some of those other places. So if you fly over our city of Knoxville, this is what you find. It takes about 15 minutes to walk from one side to the other to give you a sense of the scale of the place. It's a really small city. It's the kind of place where you know your postman as well as your mayor. And it's been a pretty good home base for us to operate in. It's given us an opportunity to work on a wide range of project types and scales and make a pretty big impact on our city in a relatively short amount of time.
So over the past 13 years since we've started our firm, we've had three offices located within the downtown core. All of those have been within a 5-minute walk from each other. Pay special attention to this slide. We're going to come back to it quite a few times, actually for reference. Because a lot of the projects that we do have a local inference to this slide. A lot of the work that we have done out of our region actually has a local connection to this slide, and sometimes the work that we've done actually all can be located or referenced back to a single block. So to give you guys a little bit of insight on how we got our start in a city which neither Brandon nor myself are actually from, I think we need to start a little bit about the city first. This is a view of the historic Market House on Market Square back in the 1930s, about 100 years ago. So it was a pretty happening place around the turn of the century. It was a key convergence between rail and river. However, the middle of the 20th century wasn't very kind to Knoxville. Actually, there was a survey done, and I think Knoxville was termed the ugliest city in America. The balance of the 20th century wasn't much better for the city, with vast residents and businesses moving from the urban core into the suburbs, much like other cities in America. It wasn't until the early 21st century until public entities and private investment groups started to look back into our urban center and start to reinvest. So this is where we come into. So fast forward to 2002. This is a picture of that same area that I sent Brandon in hopes to start a discussion with him about how we could get involved in that revitalization effort at that time. I was actually talking with some people that own some of these structures, and these opportunities are what I wanted to talk to Brandon about. And ultimately bring him hopefully to Knoxville to help participate in that work. Once he came to Knoxville, this is what opportunity to us looked like. Brandon and I both were 27 and 28 at the time. We had never done any adaptive reuse, no historic preservation. However, the people that I was talking with had just the right of balance, I believe, of enthusiasm and ignorance to trust us with their work. Over the past 13 years, we've been lucky enough to work on about 50 commissions in our urban core. And this has been kind of our growing pains over the years. We've certainly done a lot of projects that were less than glamorous along the way.
So when we were tasked with presenting our work, we had to think about what kind of framework we'd use to help us guide the talk. So we had to think about, like a lot of firms do, something to kind of bring the projects together, and try to find and identify similarities between some of the work. So try to create kind of a cataloging process as your work, a retroactive evaluation in that way. So we're no different. We started to do that, and we started to look specifically at different lenses that we could look at through to kind of see how we might categorize some of the work. And some of the lenses we looked at things like context, where a lot of the work that we were doing or have been doing is adaptive reuse projects within our urban core. We looked at typology, so we started to do more single family residential work. We looked at different physical characteristics like materiality, and also architectural techniques like layering or patterning. And what we learned is that really, you know, all these lenses are relevant to us. And while a project might share a similarity in its typology or context or materiality or technique, it's really the what makes these projects different that's interesting to us. So what are the things that led to those differences in the projects? So the title of our talk initially was Shifting Scales. And we chose the word shifting because ramping up to larger projects or staffs isn't something that we consciously are trying to do. And we've found through the years that we really enjoy working across different project types and scales, even if it means stepping back in scales every now and then. But what we also learned could be an equally relevant title here is it kind of references the stories to us, which is the most interesting part of the project. What specific stories did we develop along the course of the project that led to the different differences in the projects, or what makes these projects unique from one another? And so we're going to tell a few of those stories tonight, which capture the shift in scales in different ways, from small-scale projects and sites where the constraints are pretty clearly identifiable to larger scale sites and projects where those things aren't easily defined. We'll also take you through our city and show the kind of growth that we've seen as we've seen the scale and complexity of projects shift from small scale renovation projects to additions to ultimately new construction within our urban core.
So we'll start with the talk in that urban core that we had mentioned earlier. And this project was completed back in 2005, and actually it started in 2002. So this seems like forever ago to us. The project was 304 South Gay Street. It was located about a block from our office at that time and about a block from Market Square, which was really the epicenter of Knoxville's revitalization effort at that time. When our clients started the discussion with us, we actually convinced them to buy this building, this little red brick building here, which they considered the ugliest building in downtown Knoxville at that time. So once we got started and they purchased the building, we quickly realized that an existing fire stair took up about one half of the existing facade area. And the upper two floors had actually been renovated not that long ago. It was actually one of the reasons they bought the building, so that they could live in those upper two floors. So it really kept the scope of our work to this small front area of the building. So we quickly started to work with facade studies and massing studies and set the objective to give this naked or meek facade a new presence on Gay Street, as well as to bring light deeper into the building. It was a long, slender building, so that was one of the big issues. To do this, we carved away space at the lowest level, creating a shared entry area for the private residents above and the new tenant shell on the main level. We also carved away space for an exterior terrace on the upper level, which was their main entertaining level, creating a new outdoor patio space. We projected a new window on the second floor almost a bay window, and we were able to get light to filter through that exterior terrace space and down into that entry parlor on the second level. As you can see here, in a rendering and finished photo, that Ipe clad box of the fire stair reveals itself. It also has some new punched windows within that, which was a fire stair, now an entry stair, allowing light into that area. You can see from kind of a pure elevation photo and drawing that new zinc skin that starts to clad the living areas above. And you can really start to see how that open exterior terrace allows the light to filter into and down through the floor system and into that entrance parlor. So how did we get that light through there? It was a very simple system of simple kind of dome kind of bay skylights that you would see on a warehouse. We inserted those into the floor system and put the galvanized wall grates over top of that, allowing the light to pass through that and into that gallery space or parlor space below. A lot of the details that we did for the building, this was one of our first projects, so we were super nervous about being able to pull off just some minor details through a bid process. So we actually retained a lot of that work as owner provided contractor installed work, where we worked with local subcontractors and vendors, actually and sometimes actually doing their shop drawings for them to get the products delivered. As you can see with the finished shot, some of the neighboring buildings have some very deep articulated cornices, and we took that opportunity and did that on our structure with the stainless steel kind of cornice at the top, as well as the stainless steel gutter and cornice at the lowest at the storefront level, which carried some of the building signage. It also gave us kind of an opportunity to uplight in some concealed manner at that point for the uplighting, as well as some downlighting for the facade. You can kind of see also the skylight system with the holes penetrating that parlor space in that shot as well.
So by 2009, we had made a name for ourselves as urban adaptive reuse architects, but we didn't want to get pigeonholed as exclusively that type of architect. So we started to pursue more ground up work. And for us, the pursuit of this meant crossing our fingers and hoping, because nobody was going to trust us with an inexperienced architect like us with a project like that. So it leads us to a tiny little project that we call Cape Russell Retreat. So this project started as a property search for a client who we had done some work for in the past. We'd actually just renovated the office for this client for her marketing company, which was just about three blocks from the last project, so really close to that same block we've been focusing on. She wanted us to help her find a piece of property that she would use to build a vacation home on someday. And so we traveled with her and her partner to this site about 45 minutes north of Knoxville on Norris Lake. And the recession hit soon after that, so she put the house plans on hold, but she still wanted to do something to allow her to use this site for weekend trips to the lake. So she asked us if we would be interested in helping her to build a gazebo or some other kind of small structure on the site. So we said yes, and so we started researching some of the restrictions, and the property had a lot of restrictions. It's within Tennessee Valley Authority TVA flowage easement, the zone in yellow that you see here where we were trying to locate the building. So that comes with it a lot of restrictions of what you can and can't do since they control that easement. So we started by developing design options and looking into different programmatic things that we can include in this thing, which was starting to transform from just a gazebo to something a little bit bigger than that. Programmatically, she wanted a storage for skis, and she wanted, ideally, a small kitchenette, too. So the TVA flowage easements dictated that three sides of the structure had to be kept open. So the plan diagram is pretty simple, with the kitchenette storage box at the back and the other three sides open to maintain that flowage easement. And at this time, we were also working with or looking into photovoltaic technology and rainwater harvesting technology. So we wanted to take the project off the grid. It was located pretty far from power and water, so this would allow us to have as little site impact as possible. We also brought steel subcontractors and a carpenter on board and others to help us develop construction methods that would allow us to stay within budget and stay on track with a pretty short timeline. And we carried these little spreadsheets like this throughout the process. This was the first time we really acted more or less as construction managers throughout the process. So working with these subcontractors, we developed a system that relied on a good deal of offsite fabrication. The site was pretty difficult to get to, So that was important to do that, to fab off-site, to be able to ship to the site so we could stay on track for a six-week construction timeline. So the final plan looks pretty similar to the early diagrams that I showed. So you've got the kitchenette and storage unit located across the back. A butterfly roof directs water that's collected from the roof into a cistern located adjacent to the structure. Rooftop mounted photovoltaic cell, just one of them, powers pumps, powers the refrigerator, powers an inverter for plug-in devices and things like that as well. Now, I mentioned that it relied on a good deal of off-site fabrication, and these are some of the construction photos. So the steel structure was primarily fabricated off-site, shipped to the site, and installed into the rocky soil just through the removal of a core of the rock itself. So we just set the steel structure into that, poured concrete around it, so the existing rocks became the piers. The steel structure was fitted with steel tabs that a wood frame would attach to, and then a wood screen would hang off of that, a kind of modular panelized wood screen system. And that screen system consisted of a series of identical 1 foot wide by 10 foot tall, 2x4, just off the shelf, 2x4 cedar vertical members, and it's interspersed with ripped 2x6 members, which give it the depth and add rigidity to the structure while still allowing the transparency so you can see outside from the structure and also allow for cross ventilation. And then the back was all wrapped with insect screen to keep the bugs out. So it gives it a pretty delicate reading on approach within the landscape. And from inside, you can see how the screen provides privacy, but it doesn't eliminate views out to the forest beyond. So the photovoltaic cell installation on the roof, and you can see the pumps and stuff associated with the rainwater cistern. The rainwater cistern had a series of filters, including a UV filter, which treated the water for potable use. So approach from land, you can see the solid mass at the back. And the three sides still kept open for to satisfy the TVA flow easement requirements. And the approach from the water, you can see here with the cistern covered up with a new sheathing with the scupper directing water from the roof to the cistern. Also a sliding screen panel opens and nests to allow the inside to spill out into a small terrace space, so it effectively extends the footprint of the interior of the structure. And in the fall, the lake recedes and it exposes this rocky shoreline. So this is a fall picture, and on approach at dusk, as you can see, the light kind of filtering through this screen system. So it gives the pavilion a lantern effect at night.
So we'll go back downtown for the next discussion. This is project in 2010. We'd at that point done a lot of projects in our urban core, as you'd seen in the diagram before, retail spaces, loft conversions, restaurants of the such, total rehabilitations of buildings. However, we had never been a part of a project quite like this one from start to finish as both owner and architect. So back to the reference slide, West Jackson Workshops takes place on West Jackson Avenue. A lot of the rest of the projects will come down to West Jackson Avenue itself. Prior to this, in 2010, I actually purchased the adjacent property to it, and actually it became my home for about 6 or 7 years in a warehouse style space where I was living in at that point, I was the only person on the block. It was so undeveloped at that time. And I thought this was actually a good thing strategically. We'd be out in front of the redevelopment trends and be positioned accordingly. And unfortunately, just about the time things were getting settled with my conversion here, I was welcomed in a different manner than with new clients. We had a major fire on the street. This is my building at the time, and West Jackson Workshops here. And we lost three historic large warehouse-style buildings across the street from us, which was part of the hope that those would get redeveloped. Unfortunately, we lost three of those that day. We kind of dusted off, and of course, my house at the time got damaged a little bit. However, our passion for the district was still there. Because of the fire, the person that actually owned a lot of the buildings that were lost, he actually owned this building as well. The fire did not burn the roof off, trust me. It was always like this for many years, unfortunately, in a state of decay. But he was actually willing to sell it at this point. So we bought it in hopes to redevelop it for our office space. So quickly, when Brandon and I started working on our own project for ourselves, we quickly realized we're not very good clients. We changed our mind constantly. We had unrealistic budgets on the available money that we would have to do this property. However, once we went through the multiple iterations, we determined that we would create three unique open workshop style studio spaces for like-minded businesses like ours. We would take the center space and tenant space 102, which we actually added a second level to create our studio space and the added volume under the pitched roof. We would tuck in shared amenity spaces underneath that floor system for all of us to share. We also created a private courtyard space to the rear for our tenants to share, and a new entry court at the front. Our architectural strategy was just about as simple as the pro forma and the program. We utilized all of the parts and pieces that we bought, which wasn't very much, but we did have a good structural system with our open web trusses and load-bearing masonry walls. We utilized all of those existing openings and to bring as much light into those studio spaces as possible. We kept the existing garage door opening in its location and recessed our new entrance courtyard into that area under the new free span roofing system that utilized the existing steel work. Branding was the next part of the project. Both applied graphics and integrated signage was part of the project. This was not just about our office. This was something bigger and more inclusive to the district. So once we got finished in 2010, we had a fantastic studio space, however no tenants, that we much needed to pay for all of this work. So we had empty tenant spaces, so we quickly turned those into temporary gallery spaces, had First Friday events, and soon thereafter, we got great response, and we had assembled up to five unique businesses that agreed to share the two spaces on either side of us under our roof. So we had creative types, artists, writers, event planners, graphic designers, photographers, all housed under our new roof. This is a shot of our studio. The lower shots actually is how it's ever rarely looked. And as you can see, it's in much more lived in today with full of life and light. Back in 2014, of course, the economy's getting better. Development is starting to come towards our area. And we're hearing chatter about a new RFP for the remaining historic warehouses across the street from us, the ones that remain from the fire. However, in February of 2014, 8 years ago, 8 years to the day almost, we lost the balance of the four buildings, unfortunately to a campfire, to some people experiencing homelessness. As you can see, the building remains. We've made it through some pretty tragic events on this area of our downtown. My old house is now a distillery. A brewery, restaurants actually going in right up a couple doors up. All of the available businesses and buildings have been filled. And now, unfortunately, we're waiting for an RFP to be issued for the now vacant land across the street from us.
So the first project that we completed within that office was for a house on the Intercoastal Waterway in Vero Beach, Florida. This house was for clients who actually lived on the same block on West Jackson Avenue. So they lived just about a block from where our office was located. And it was a beautiful site. It was in an old neighborhood filled with mid-century homes, and they were slowly being replaced with a bunch of houses that have become typical stylistically that you might find in Central Florida. And this project gave both the owners and us a little bit of heartburn when we first visited the site. They'd already made the decision at that time to remove their own mid-century home and replace it with a new building. So on this first site visit, we immediately noticed this is the mid-century home surrounded by all these beautiful live oak trees. So it was really clear to us early on what the main constraint that would drive this project would be keeping these live oak trees. So this slide shows some of those replacement houses that I was talking about, that they're removing the mid-century houses and replacing with these. So it's really destroyed the character of the neighborhood simply because each one of these houses dwarfs the scale and character of those existing mid-century homes. So in contrast to that, our client actually wanted to go in the other direction. They wanted to do a smaller house. We were able to work with them to create efficiencies in the plan and actually give them a smaller house at the end of the day. So The decision was made early on that any design option that we would present would fit within the footprint of the existing original house so that we could protect and preserve those live oak trees. We always cast a wide net in our design process early on. So we do a series of wildly different design options. And we do that not just to bring our clients along through the process, we also do that to convince ourselves as designers that what we're doing is right, that we're making the right decisions along the way. And these extend to three-dimensional studies as well. And we really describe the design process kind of like a funnel, where this wide range of design ideas starts out in the wide part of the funnel. And as you move through the design process, the focus of the project narrows to it, where it comes out at the bottom. What comes down to the bottom of the funnel is a clear and concise design direction that has equal support from both the owner and the architect. So in terms of the form of this project, this is how all of that evolved. And really, this project is the first time we had ever done a loft in a house. And we learned that it's really hard to do a loft in a house without just doing a two-story house. So our design decision here, really, the form became the consequence of the decision to add the loft. So what I mean is that the house shifts in form across the north side of the building, which fronts the intercoastal waterway, from a one-story house to a two-story house across the length of the public space. And it wasn't just a purely kind of form-driven project. We're working through plan options as well. So we were figuring out a way to where we could incorporate these vertical masses, which would kind of divide volume across that front of the building, which faces to the intercoastal waterway. And each one of these masses would be programmed with things like kitchen elements, or a media room, or a library, or the master bathroom. We also were working through physical models and trying to get a good understanding of the volume of some of these spaces, and also start to look specifically at how the exterior materials start to layer from one to another. And on the outside of the house, it's a really simple restrained materials palette, just three materials, starting with the primary volume, which is clad in cementitious stucco over concrete and CMU. And that's a pretty common method of building in the area, since hurricane codes pretty much dictate that you build a bomb shelter here. The secondary or accessory volumes that project out from the main form are clad in an iron spot brick, which comes from Nebraska. I've just been told, we've seen it here as well, an Endicott iron spot brick. The third opaque material is Western red cedar, which clads insets, it clads an entry canopy, and folds down to become the front door. And flip to the other side, this is the view from the intercoastal waterway. So that's simply a series of 10-foot tall, hurricane-rated sliding doors that really open up the expanse of that space that lines the waterway to a terrace with those big panoramic views of the waterway. And I really love this photo because it gives a good sense of the scale. This is our client pushing one of those 10-foot doors open after a morning run. And approaching from the other side, the cedar, you can see again wrapping down to become the entry door. And there were limitations with hurricane codes working through this entire process. So this is actually cedar cladding an existing hurricane-rated door that had withstood, been proven to withstand large missile impact. You can also get a sense of the transparency through the house as you're looking through past the stair and to that sliding door system leading to views of the intercoastal waterway. On the interior of the house, it was an equally restrained material palette of just polished concrete, white painted walls for a gallery kind of effect for the display of artwork, and also cherry, which acted as an inset material within these vertical masses. The stair, we wanted to have a level of refinement to it that wouldn't allow for things like field welds. So the stair is designed as components that are fabricated in the shop, and they're powder coated, sent back to the site, and installed with a series of counterboard stainless steel fasteners. And looking again at a kind of dawn picture from the other side, we can still see the live oak trees which circle the house, and they're still maintained and healthy.
So the next shift in scale for us actually mirrors a shift in scale for our city as well. As I'd mentioned earlier, a kind of a strategic move to be a part of West Jackson Avenue was the pattern of growth for development and redevelopment, and this is one of those projects, the Southeastern Glass Building. So the Southeastern Glass Building actually is positioned at the main gateway entry onto West Jackson Avenue and actually into downtown from one of the main thoroughfares, Broadway, coming from a north-south corridor and coming in from the west side. So the new owner of this 30-era structure, after he purchased it, we ran into each other, and literally he was so excited he bought it. He'd always wanted the building, and he literally asked, what do we do with it? He actually didn't have a plan for it. Unfortunately, the building had been flipped about three times in the past 5 years, each person making money each time, making development scenarios specifically hard along the way. And now he's got the most expensive purchase for us to work with. Another challenging part of the project is actually its shape. As you can see, the building itself takes kind of an acute angle or flat iron shape to the North Broadway and Jackson Avenue corridors. There was some available property that came with the purchase, and it actually extended all the way to the east to the adjacent building. Not only was money site a constraint, the building is actually five stories tall in this photo. It's actually got two full levels below Jackson Avenue, which made up over half of the square footage that he purchased, which we would need to figure out how to put back into service. So of course, our early task in any project like this is to run development pro formas and try to make sense out of all this so that it can get built and paid for. As he bought it was around 63% efficient. These are just math equations for us. We have to get these numbers right to make the project work. We looked at adding a fourth floor, or actually a sixth floor in this situation, to the top of the building. We only got that around 65% efficient. You've got to be around 75 or 80% to make a development work. We even looked at infilling the entire east side with new square footage. However, at that time, that was way too much risk for this area to bear. So we determined the level of risk that was appropriate for the project at that time. We actually removed some in some previous scenarios. We were going to add to the east side of the building, housing new elevator and stair elements. We were actually going to add to the top of the structure, as we had shown before, with new residential space. We actually were going to infill an elevator shaft that actually was sized for automobiles that used to traverse vertically within the building when they put glass into the building that was its previous use. And then ultimately, we had a very difficult decision of infilling a existing drive-through one-story element at the corner to turn it back into commercial space, upping our percentage to make the project work. As you can see from some of the diagrams here, the existing conditions and then the new program kind of wrapping up vertically and then over the existing structure, those program elements ultimately being wrapped with a new skin and roof plane system, ultimately creating kind of a reveal between the new and the old. This building was on the State Historic Registry, so we had to be very sensitive to those issues. You can see from this rendering, again, that reveal between new and old and how some of the program elements start to lay out. Three stories of residential space would occur above the main West Jackson corridor, which was office space or retail space. The amenities would be pushed to those levels below the West Jackson Avenue, and we're actually able to put some residential units down there due to the extreme topography slope across the slope to the rear. Those actually daylight out to the north. Again, a finished shot, seeing the that reveal between new and old in this shot, specifically with the new residential entrance and the building signage at this corner. Not only was that reveal super important for registry issues, but it was also the creation of outdoor spaces for our residential tenants within the building. Again, back to a plan, these are regular shapes that we had to work with and try to put normal type spaces like residential type bedrooms and things within that irregular shape was quite a struggle for us, but we hoped those started to work out accordingly. The new addition that we added to the top floor was very orthogonal, actually leaving those negative kind of triangular shaped spaces over to now upper patios for the new penthouse tenants. Exposed masonry, of course, and concrete systems remained exposed to kind of celebrate the historic nature of the building and transposing those with new residential finishes within. A view from kind of the north looking to the south, again seeing that reveal happening on that side as well as in section and in elevation with the upper penthouse level completely surrounded by glass, which was really kind of in contrast to the heavy brick and concrete below. We were super lucky to kind of finish the work in the building in some of those commercial spaces that I mentioned earlier. And this was that space that happened at that corner condition that I shared earlier. We were lucky enough to work with a colleague of ours to do his furniture showroom within that kind of what was a previous drive-through space, and kind of now it's occupying that very special corner in that main gateway entrance to our downtown.
So as we started to complete more residential projects, we started to get more calls. And while these might be pretty different in terms of their scale or their context, we try to approach each of these projects in a similar way, which really starts with an analysis of the site, see what kind of unique challenges might be presented by that or what kind of opportunities might be present. So in a similar way to the urban projects, we really try to look to the site to help us set the stage for the project, to help us write the first chapter of the story of the project. So this is the Holston River House, which is designed for our first tenant in West Jackson Workshops. So again, a connection back to that same block. This is a beautiful site. It's about a 20-minute drive from downtown Knoxville, in the most remote part of Knox County that you can find. So it's got views to the north to the Clinch Mountain Range. It's got access to the Holston River to the east. And when we first came to the site, this is a photograph from our first site visit. It seemed like a pretty straightforward project with the open field with those views. So we thought it would be a pretty easy project to start design work on. But we were all kind of drawn to this other, more private part of the site, which is located in the woods. It's an area that's covered with rocks and cedar trees. And our client asked us immediately as we're walking through the site if it would be possible to even build within a landscape that was like this. And not having any idea whether you could or couldn't, we just said, yeah, we can do that. And this is a picture from that same site visit at the top, which shows the character of that space. So we called it a moonscape, and it's kind of a lunar condition. If cedar trees were to grow on the moon, that's what I think it would look like. So they really wanted to bring this type of experience into the building. They wanted that to be a part of the house. So programmatically, it was pretty simple, really. It's a couple, and they just have three different things that they wanted. They wanted a space to entertain, a space for the occasional guest, and then a space that they could retreat into the landscape. So we organized those three volumes. We kind of bundled them together into just three things and organized them around this central gathering space in the middle of the building and kind of dislocated them so that each one of the volumes could maintain three exposures. And we also wanted to work with the existing site as much as possible, so to limit the amount of excavation as much as possible. So we proposed a concrete foundation and limited the extent of that just to the garage area and then ultimately to where the kitchen is and where the master bathroom is so that it could enclose pipes and things like that. But where that foundation or crawl space wasn't needed, the volumes, which you can see above that, were organized on top of that kind of concrete datum. They would just extend out over that concrete foundation into the landscape. So those three volumes were organized around the central space, which provided access to the landscape on both sides, which was somewhat reminiscent of the dog trot condition, which I don't know if you have that in Nebraska or not, but it's a common kind of vernacular type to East Tennessee. And this is a view of that interior of that kind of dog trot space. So you can imagine the windows opening up in more seasonable weather. So during entertaining, people are able to spill out on both sides of the house. It was 0 degrees when we did this photo shoot, literally. Outside, it became an exercise in layering, really. So the layers of the project, it started with that concrete datum, which came into contact with the ground in every condition. The three volumes, which are now, we identified them as just simply public, private, and accessory. Those are clad in cedar, which is a reference to the existing cedar grove that the house was located within. And then it was all capped with this standing seam metal wrapper, which just capped and unified the entire thing. And in areas where you were to access the inside of the building, we'd lift the wrapper up. And at those moments where the wrapper was lifted up, we integrated a gutter into that system so it would protect you walking in and also protect these cedar areas. So you can see one of those conditions where the wrapper is lifted up. In this case, these are rocks that were excavated from the site, and they provide access to this central gathering space on the left and also an outdoor shower on the right. So you can see the gutter system coming down at the areas where the wrapper's lifted. And where the wrapper's not lifted, water just sheets down the standing seam panels to a continuous French drain that circles the entire structure. And we, in the design stages, we really wanted to create two unique type of experiences of being in the landscape. We wanted to frame these distant views at the bottom, which are views that kind of put you in the treetops, these elevated views out into the landscape. And then we wanted these intimate views at the top, which were the ones that really framed the connection to the rock outcroppings outside. And inside, see one of the photos from looking through this frame of the rocks as the rocks come up towards the house, the master bathroom, and the gathering space. And the photo on the left is looking through that dog trot space from the accessory volume towards a master bathroom. So that becomes the elevated condition where that volume projects over the landscape. And this is kind of a view from that space. And at the living volume, the volume projects out again over the concrete foundation, and it creates another unique type of outdoor space. So it's a space that's framed by the living room volume floating over your head on the left, and the cedar wraps around to really become a ceiling condition in that spot as well. And it's a really neat space because it's got the stone that still remains and was uninterrupted during the construction process. So that frames part of the space, and also again that living room volume floating over your head. So with the majority of this kind of rocky moonscape preserved, the house really becomes a natural part of the landscape, and it really kind of nestles within this existing cedar thicket.
So back downtown. So as Brandon mentioned earlier, the real estate market in areas like ours typically drives development at a typically slower pace than areas, say, like Nashville, where development has been booming for the last five or six years with new multifamily developments happening all over the city. Our city's grown over those same number of years, however, not at quite the same pace. So what we're about to share with you now is seven new row houses on Vine Avenue in downtown Knoxville. Back to the reference slide again, you can start to see its positioning. We actually share a kind of a common corner with our office to this site, just behind our office space. We're not the developer of the property, however, we've been involved in this site for almost 9 years now, and we think now is the time for this project to happen due to the market. Historically, Knoxville's had some fantastic residential streets. Unfortunately, they have been lost to history. This is a view from Broadway at the intersection of Vine Avenue at that time, which is a main thoroughfare still for our city. Doing a row house type project in Knoxville, this was probably the first one in probably 30 years or more. And probably the first, hopefully good one, in the last probably 100 years. So we started to look at this typology that is typical to cities like New York, Philadelphia, and Washington, and tried to figure out what made this typology and what made it make great residential streets. So of course we investigate the size and kind of scale of these structures, what types of spaces happen inside the building and outside the building, and most importantly, how those areas and spaces touch the street edge. We also looked at this typology within our own city. As you can see here from the red points, there's only a few left within our city and even fewer in our main downtown core. Over the past few years, we've actually worked on a few of these projects. Either small interventions, renovation of them, and we actually own a couple just north of downtown. So we know a little bit about this typology, but nothing on the scale that we're about to embark on now. Other projects that have just recently happened in our downtown, we actually looked at those to see what they didn't have to get hopefully a competitive edge with our product once it goes to market. We noticed they did have green space or exterior spaces, however, they were all shared. We also saw that most of those had off-street parking or some sort of shared kind of parking lot situation where we thought we could potentially provide that on ours. So taking you to the site itself, the actual site is actually the highest point in our downtown area. positioned very well for this type of development. You can see from the site plan, we immediately took the proportion of a standard row house and quickly determined that the width of the site would allow us about 7 units due to its width. There is a topography change from the main street level to the rear of the site that allows us to get this kind of split level condition, which is very typical to this project typology. As you can see from this cross section, the main two living levels above and then pink level there, you can start to see a garden space that's accessed from a kind of a recessed patio area accessed from the street. And this is very common to this typology. It could be a rental space or a mother-in-law suite on that level. The garden space or patio that we just spoke about is one of 3 spaces or exterior spaces provided. We actually are proposing a new deck to the rear off the main living level and then a roof outdoor terrace that would give 360 degree views, panoramic views to the city. And of course, kind of this clutch thing that happens in our southern region that ultimately drives a lot of development projects is parking. So we're proposing to provide a 2-car garage that's accessed from a rear drive that we think will really set our project apart from the rest. In terms of materials, we really wanted the building to convey a sense of permanence and appropriateness not really kind of found on project typologies such as this. So a sense of refinement and sophistication is hopefully something we're going to achieve. We're proposing board form concrete as a base or a datum at the lowest level with an iron spot, again from Nebraska brick, on the upper levels. Any of the spaces that reach out to the main form that reaches into those exterior spaces are clad in metal with an Ipe cladding on those interior faces. This actually reminds us of another project we're working on in the same area, so we've taken a few cues from it. On the building to the left, this connection from the street through the portico and up to the roof deck that's all unified by a common stair. And you can see that in our study model here that we've tried to propose for this new build. So we're in the home stretch on construction documents. We literally should be working on those right now. The materials palettes are starting to be set. We hope bringing that same level of refinement and sophistication to the interiors. And hopefully what we've created will have a scale and character that will bring back some of those good characteristics of a historic residential street. And ultimately that will be a good neighbor to us down on West Jackson below.
So we'll move out of Knoxville again for the next project. We've had the opportunity to work on some beautiful sites, and this is probably one of the prettiest and largest sites we've been able to work on. These sites like this typically don't have the same constraints that you have working in an urban area. You don't have existing buildings. You don't have these urban zoning codes. So it can kind of give you a long leash as a designer, and maybe a little bit too long from time to time. So you might have the tendency to try a little bit hard or do a little bit too much. So we try to approach a project like this with restraint in mind, trying to limit the formal complexity or the materials palette or even the scale of the building to try to make the experience of being on the site be elevated or heightened by the architecture, not taken away by that. So this project is a church, an Anglican church south of Nashville. When I got a call in 2014 from this client, he was describing the area in general and the site in particular. And as he was describing it, I realized that this site is about 3 miles from where I grew up. So in a suburb south of Nashville. So it's really close to home for me. Became a local project. So for us, this was kind of a dream commission, a chance to move up in scale. On a project that's really public or almost civic in nature. So we put a lot of pressure on ourselves, and probably a little bit too much pressure, I think. And maybe we tried a little too hard in the beginning. But the way we approached the project, we started to try to look at different kind of formal strategies of how building and site could be integrated. And I think we prioritized building over site a little bit too much in the process. So when we presented to the building committee for this church, the first presentation fell a little bit flat. The building was kind of compact. It was a 36-acre site, and it was kind of compact on the site. It was inwardly focused, so it didn't quite feel right to us or to the building committee. So when we reined ourselves in a little bit as we moved towards the next meeting, we kind of zoomed out and started to look at the site specifically. Again, we wanted to look at the same thing. What kind of challenges does it have? What kind of opportunities does the site present? And in this case, what we found were really three different very unique types of landscapes on the site, on the 35 acres. There was a meadow at the kind of front of the site, which was fronted to the street. There was a forested hillside at the rear of the site behind you in this photo, and there was this kind of grove type in between space, which was the mediator between the two. And that's where we proposed to site the building during the next design iterations. So similar to some of the other diagrams, we really worked to kind of simplify the program to just the key core elements. And we placed those on the site alongside the parking that would be required for a building like this, and it freaked us out a whole lot when we saw that. So we all had this goal of having the building connect to the site and the site connect back to the building. So we saw this as an opportunity to add programmed outdoor space. And the addition of this programmed outdoor space might allow us to kind of balance out the parking and building's relationship to the site. And the next step was to look at that outdoor programmed outdoor space and start to kind of carve it and redistribute it in between the different pieces of building program. So really our effect here was to, rather than just placing the building within a garden, we cut the garden into smaller pieces and place these gardens within the building. And we looked to historic precedent again to try to get a good understanding of the relationship that we wanted to achieve between interior and exterior space. We looked at some historic precedents as well to try to get an understanding of how outdoor space can be defined by building. And we wanted to understand also what level of enclosure might be appropriate for different types of spaces. And so we went back to work developing more design options. And we start with design option five here. And again, we're casting a wide net here. We start with five because 1 through 4 we basically threw away after the first meeting. So again, we bundled the program into the primary elements here and started to organize those on the site in a way that, in this case, what you're seeing, the differences in these are specifically dealing with orientation of the sanctuary, which is important, and also how each of these program volumes, how it's impacted by its relationship to different parts of the site. So fast forward a couple of months, and this is the conclusion that we reached, that was presented. And what we've got is the color-coded primary masses of the building, which help to define these outdoor spaces. So then with the outdoor spaces, these programmed areas, we started to assign functions and uses to those spaces and to give names to those spaces as well. So the large open spaces that you see in green became the garden spaces. The smaller light gray spaces that you see, we started to call plaza spaces. And then the white spaces that you see between the building program elements and the landscape was something that we called porches, and the porches became that in-between space that connected built program with the landscape space, the transition space. Materiality was also really important. So again, we approached the project with restraint in mind. We wanted to limit the materials palette to just a few key primary natural materials, both inside and out. And for us, there was technically a fourth material, which was glass. But for us in this project, glass is really the absence of material. So what we were trying to do was create these panoramic conditions to frame views and bring the landscape in. And the landscape in that way becomes the de facto fourth material in the project. So how the volumes are arranged around the landscape and how they defined these spaces, you can see the evolution of that, where the red elements are those primary building program elements, which define those outdoor spaces. The blue elements are these kind of larger congregating spaces that are adjacent to each one of those, that serve each one of those volumes. And we started to call those garden rooms. And then just this limited palette of materials and how those are associated with each of those volumes. So looking in section, again, moving inside the building, this is an Anglican church, and there is a restrained materials palette, kind of a quiet materials palette. So you can get a quality of how that, or a sense of the quality of how that exists within the landscape. and also really how the sanctuary volume itself that these sections are cut through becomes that mediator space between, on the top, a prayer garden on the left and the meadow garden on the right, and on the bottom, how the sanctuary volume sits within one of the plaza spaces. So entry plaza on the left extending through the sanctuary to where it becomes a forest plaza behind. So the sanctuary really sits in a plaza. So on approach, you can get a sense of the kind of outside to in layering sequence that we're proposing, where the lower volume is the entry volume, and that's clad in a native stone. And then back a layer from that is the cementitious stucco clad narthex volume, which is raised a little bit higher and folds up to become a raised chapel tower piece. And that frames the sanctuary, just an austere volume that sits back behind those spaces. And on the bottom, you can get a sense of one of these panoramic conditions where this is a porch space, in this case, connecting fellowship to meadow garden. So the panoramic condition of that sequence, and also the view through to one of the plaza spaces beyond. So we're trying to always create these connections through the building to other parts of the landscape. And on approach from the road, you can get a sense of the kind of three types of spaces that are set up. So we preserve the meadow in the foreground, the building sits within that grove space as a mediator, and the wooded hillside really sets the backdrop for the project, with the chapel being the last building element that you see. So I want to kind of conclude this theme of shifting scales by talking about another shift that we've taken on in recent years. And it's really a shift towards more impactful public work, which for us was started with the pursuit of public projects. So we've been involved in a few small-scale public projects. It's really where it started for us, these small-scale installations that happen for cultural groups, or in some cases permanent pieces that are commissioned by public entities. And we're proud of some of those, but they're not these big-scale public commissions that we're pursuing.
And that pursuit for larger public work is really a challenge. We gave a lecture a few years back, and I think we were 0 for 23 at that time for public sector RFQs. The ones that we have gotten to date have been small. They've had small budgets, super long timelines, and even tighter fees. So that romantic vision for doing that type of work has been much more restrained over these past few years. We have learned, though, however, doing public work can sometimes lead to private work, or vice versa. We were awarded a commission as a team member for this public infrastructure project, connecting the University of Tennessee campus to the South Knoxville waterfront for the city of Knoxville, over a stretch of river that has yet to be crossed in probably 100 years or so with a new bridge structure.
So the team lead on this project was an engineer, and while we did have some involvement in the design of the bridge, our primary involvement was a really difficult connection that existed on the south waterfront, where you have a grade change of 50 feet from the bridge deck down to the grade. So most bridges connect high point to high point, and that wasn't the case in this one. So rather than proposing to bring down this 50-foot gap through a series of ramps and elevators and things that are typical, we propose to bring the ground up to the bridge through the creation of a series of elevated terraces. So each one of these elevated terraces would become developable tracks, and they would increase in scale and density as you reach towards the water. And this project it's been funded. The city's made a commitment to fund the project, and we're waiting to see if the federal government will provide a grant to fund the remainder of the project. We'll find out this fall. So I want to zoom out a little bit and show how this impacts another project that we're working on right now. This is South Knoxville, and the area that's highlighted right there is the area of the bridge where I just showed. And a little bit of history on this part of South Knoxville, Knoxville was not, there wasn't a big Civil War battle ever fought in Knoxville, but we do have the remnants of several forts along this stretch of river that date back to the Civil War. A couple of these forts have already been converted to public parks. So down south a little bit from that area is an area that we're working on with a foundation. And the project is to design an artist-in-residence community on this undisturbed ridgetop, just about 5 miles from, or 5 minutes from downtown Knoxville. So we're in the early stages of development with this client. The project ultimately will be the rehabilitation of a bunch of existing buildings into artist studios, performance spaces, and things like that. So you know, we're happy to do this project because it's going to preserve hundreds of acres of this hillside and create a destination within something that Knoxville has already branded the urban wilderness. So it's really a super exciting project. And so our client's parcel is in a position to be combined with a series of other parcels that are owned by a combination of public and private sector groups, which are the ones that are all shown in green. And our client right now is in the stages or about to start the development of what they're calling the Battlefield Loop Master Plan. So this artist in residence community will be a part of a network of connections and will ultimately connect to a series of existing hiking and biking trails, which already is over 35 miles with more trails added each year. So we're going to break ground on the first stage of this artist in residence project next week, and then we'll start with the design of the rehabilitation of other buildings into these artist studios and performance spaces soon after that.
So here we are, back to kind of where we started. I think what we want to emphasize with this inclusion with this talk tonight is to kind of emphasize how connections occur, how those ultimately lead to your next opportunity, and then kind of the realization of how all those things kind of start to overlap. With this kind of understanding, I think it's kind of an obvious statement to the understanding of doing good work no matter at what scale it occurs at. These are just some of our chapters in our story, and we really appreciate you guys having us tonight to share some of those with you. Thanks.
So we take some questions if you guys have questions. Eric, you have a question?
I actually do have a question.
There you go.
It seemed like the majority of your design decisions were based on constraints that were given to you. Mm-hmm. But the West Jackson workshop, mm-hmm. if I'm correct, it almost lacked constraints because it was your own design and your own office. How did you overcome that? How did you find those constraints that you felt were necessary?
Her wallet. It was the biggest constraint. It really was. We had multiple scenarios of what we wanted to do with the space. I mean, the site was very limited. It's landlocked. It's zero property lines. There's nothing outside of it. So that's constraint. Utilizing what's there to kind of celebrate the old historic building is a constraint. So then you start to kind of whittle those things down and make sure you understand what's important that you want to keep, and then budget, schedule, things of that nature will also start to really push you in a corner. So I think we did that project for, I think, $75 or $80 a square foot. And if a client came to us to ask us to do that same project, I would never tell them that number. I have no idea how we actually did it to this day. So we did it, and it was a good learning experience. But I would probably tell our client that was $125 a square foot, not $80 a square foot. Yeah.
For the church project, did the client either at the beginning or in the process get real involved in the symbolism of what the church has to be?
That project, the stage of the project that I showed, it's actually in conceptual design. It's in schematic design, I guess. We may have gotten close to design development. So all of that, we have a consultant that's not on board yet that's going to help us with some of that stuff as we get into the kind of interior of the space. So I mean, there's a lot of tradition in the Anglican Church that we could draw from in that. And we did our own research with that and presented that as part of the earlier presentations as well, just about how the space would be organized. But about the specifics of that, that's going to come from a consultant down the road.
But they've seen it so far and they're not now.
No. Is there anything that they should be flipping out about? Are you an Anglican Church consultant?
No. I'm just wondering if they were asking for more statues, or cisterns, or this and that.
Yeah, no, and they really, really were driving us to strip this thing down. They wanted it to be very, very minimal. Again, you know, it's expense wasn't really the issue to drive that. So they wanted the materials to be nice, but they didn't want any kind of extravagance within that.
Well, thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
Appreciate being here. Thank you.